Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Good. It is an incredible joy and pleasure to be here. When I grew up in San Mateo and Belmont, I grew up reading Herb Cain every day in the Chronicle. And Herb Cain would quite frequently mention the speakers at the Commonwealth Club. And my dream at that time was to someday be mentioned in one of the Herb Cain articles. I took a little longer than Herb was planning on. But it is so great to be here today that I thought I might talk for just a little while about the concept of dreams and maybe where they come from and what led to this biography that Gina just handled so well in 3 minutes. It was a little longer in the living. But I thought I would start with kind of the first memories I had and why I developed the dream to be a writer. I come from a very large family, six brothers and sisters, and my mom and dad. We were an intact family until my mom and dad passed on. But one of the things that was most important in my early life, which I will never forget, and continued well into my adulthood, is my father was an insurance salesman. And he had been a serviceman during World War II. He was shot down over Japan. He was a prisoner of war. And then he came out of the service, married my mother, and started raising us children who appeared at a rate of about one every 12 months. Good Catholic man, very religious, believed in birth control. Not. Believed in the rhythm method. But one of the things, my dad was a great guy, and one of the things that he did every night is he would do his job, he'd come home around 5:30, and he would pour himself a bourbon and water, and he would sit down and grab a book. And he had what we called the big chair in the living room. And he would sit in the big chair and open the book and sip his bourbon and water while my mother made dinner for the seven of us, and he would become completely lost. And this is not to say that he was not there for us if an explosion happened, as often did, but he was just like a Buddha sitting there in his chair as a dad, much like a big dog might sit in the hall, just being there if we needed him, but otherwise really oblivious and in another place. And it became obvious how important this endeavor was to him just in the course of our lives together. We had this almost every single day. He would sit in the chair while absolute pandemonium reigned around him. Seven children, you can imagine. We have only two, and two I often felt like pandemonium. But seven is beyond my imagination. I can't even think of what it must have really been like. Every time we get back together, even as adults, it's insane. And so when we were, you know, even younger and crazier than we are now, it must have been truly insane. But he'd just sit there like this. And sometimes we would all kind of get it and just sit around and watch him read quietly. And it was the quiet more than the pandemonium that would clue him that we were paying attention to what he was doing. He'd look up and he'd go, oh, it's okay, I'm just reading. And that was the kind of moments, those were the kind of moments that I think planted in my head the idea that reading was an extremely important endeavor and writing was an extremely important endeavor. And I would say to my dad, you know, what is it you really want to do? I mean, why are you so drawn to this particular thing? He said to me, this is the most important thing in the world outside of my family. This is what you know, brings me into the bigger world and makes me aware of things that I don't know. And we talked about this stuff all the time, and he wanted to be a writer. He was very aware of the, you know, the desperate life of the suburban man. I mean, he would often say this to us as we got older and we talked. He would say, you know, I'm glad I made a living and I'm glad I could raise you kids, but if you get a chance to do something that you love and you dare to dream for it, you should do that. Because, you know, maybe having 7 kids wasn't the best idea of all time. He said, of course, I'd do it again tomorrow, a little bit of a lie for our benefit. But nevertheless, he would go out of his way to tell all of us to do something that we love to do. And so when I developed this early dream, you know, reading Herb Cain in the morning, I would often say to him over coffee, I would say, so look at who's at the Commonwealth Club today. And my dad worked over here right at 111 Sutter, and quite often he would come here and hear who was talking at the Commonwealth Club. He was a very intellectual guy, although he was not a college graduate. And he made this forum and this whole approach so important to all of us, all of the kids in my family, that this is really, I have to say, one of the highlight lights of my life so far tonight. So it's a long introduction, but I just really wanted to say thank you again for inviting me here. It's truly a dream come true. But much like Gina glossed over some of the little introductory points of my life, I'd like to tell you a few stories that indicate how important story is in my life. And the first thing about this is the story of my father and mother's courtship. This is something that's part of our family's heritage, and I am so proud of it. I'll try to get through it without sobbing, but it's a true story. My father met my mother at Reese Park Beach in New York when she was 17 and he was 18. They dated for about 7 months, and then Pearl Harbor happened. When Pearl Harbor happened, my father enlisted the next day. My mother, who had lied about her age both to my father and to everybody else, was in fact only 15 years old, although she was a college graduate. She was an orphan, and the best way to get her out of the house was to put her in school. And so she became a college graduate at the age of 15. So she met my dad when she was an underage little thing, and I think they really fell in love. And what happened was, is my dad then, you know, the war started. My dad joined the Air Force and got a job as a bombardier navigator, and my mother joined the Red Cross and went overseas to Switzerland to serve in the Red Cross. During the next 4 years, they communicated as often as they could, but it was rather haphazard. And then my father was shot down on his last mission over Tokyo Bay. And he was taken prisoner by the Japanese and brought to a prisoner of war camp in Japan. And he spent the last 8 weeks of the war there. He started his time there at a weight of 170 pounds, and he left at a weight of 101 pounds. Then when he got out, he went to the Philippines for rest and recreation. And of course, nobody had heard of him for all that time. They thought he was dead. And he wrote a really long, told you, it's going to be hard for me. But he wrote a beautiful letter to my mother, telling her that he loved her and that he wanted to see her again and, you know, take up where they left off 5 years before. Well, because of the communications issues between the various camps right after the war, my mother had this letter was heavily edited to the extent that basically all she got was a telegram. And the telegram said, return to states, object matrimony. That's what we call editing. So anyway, she returned to the States, and 3 days later, married my father, and it was all good. Anyway, this is the power of story to me. Story is what makes life livable. Putting some kind of narrative around something that makes it worthwhile and maybe gives it a bigger importance than it has. So that when I came to the point that I wanted to decide or had to decide how I wanted to live my life, I took my father's advice to heart, and I said, you know, this is, we are in a vocational family. We didn't grow up learning to get a job so that we could just live. We wanted to be living, doing what we dreamed to be doing. And I believe in my family of the seven of us, I think probably certainly five of us are doing just that, which is, I think, a tremendous testament to my parents and how they raised us. But in my case, for some reason, I don't know why, the way that I felt whole was by putting words on pages. And I did it through poetry when I was in high school and college. I did it through short stories. And then I tried novels. And one of the things about novels is that novels are really long. And novels take time, and novels take commitment. And one of the things that most kids, and certainly I, didn't have as a child, was patience. I have a few people in the audience here tonight who I'm sure will tell you that that's still true. It's not my best quality, patience. But you need that if you want to be a novelist, because a story takes time to develop. So what I started doing when I decided I was going to be a novelist is I started to write a page a day. A page a day is a good amount to write if you want to be a writer. The first reason being that a page a day will give you a book in 1 year. The second reason is that a page a day is a manageable amount. If you cannot write a page a day, and any of you want to be writers out there and you're not writing a page a day or find you can't do it, might I suggest you're not a writer. And that's fine. There's a lot of other great things to do. But in my case, writing a page a day was one of the most important things that I began doing when I was in my mid-20s. Even when I was still being a musician, I would come home and I wasn't writing necessarily a page a day of a novel. I was just writing a page a day to write one page every day. It was a little bit bizarre, but I didn't have, strangely enough, I didn't have any stories. I hadn't lived long enough. I could have written my father's story, I suppose, but that felt a little secondhand to me since it wasn't my story. And eventually I decided, oh, wait a minute, maybe it's not a matter of inspiration. Through all these one page at a time days, I said, you know what, this is not really a matter of waiting for the idea to strike. What this is really all about is the discipline to sit down and do it and put it within a formula that led to something. And so I started my first novel. Actually, I'd written a novel as an exercise in college, and then I'd written another dumb old mystery right after college. And I practiced how to write stories. And then I wrote another literary novel, the one that Gina referred to that won this award here, given by the San Francisco Foundation. I love this city. I wrote another novel that was a literary novel. And then I went back and I published my first Sherlock Holmes novel, which is the one I wrote right after I finished college. Fortunately, that got published. And my publisher asked for a sequel, which was another Sherlock Holmes novel. And then I decided, since I wasn't making any money at those, that I would write a Dismas Hardy novel. I didn't know what that was in those days. But suddenly I was on book four, and I said, I've got to write a modern book, and I've got to have it be commercial because I got to make a little money. This is crazy. I was working two jobs in Los Angeles and being pretty busy, and I was going out every morning in my garage, and now I was up to four pages I was trying to do every day. So it didn't take me that long to write Dead Irish, and it was a pretty good story. Got nominated for Best Mystery Novel that year, which was great. Then I wrote The Vig, same idea, same kind of thing, an exercise, how to get your story done, how to make it readable. But here I had now done five books, and I was still absolutely failing in a commercial sense. So I was about to change things, and then the spinal meningitis episode happened that Gina just referred to earlier, and I was in a coma for 11 days and came out. By this time, I was 41 years old, and you say, wow, time flies when you're having fun. But here I was, 41 years old, and I had really never written a novel that was from my insides. I never really wrote the book that captured what I wanted to do with my literary side, if I have one, and what I wanted to do with the side that loves a plot and loves suspense. And suddenly I said, you know what, this is the time. I'm already 41. I do have some stories I think I can tell. So I sat down and I wrote a book with a very different premise, where Dismas Hardy suddenly, luckily, was the lawyer that I had made him an ex of back early on. My very first book with him, I had made him an ex-lawyer. And I decided to bring him back to the law, and that gave me a palette that was much larger, that suddenly I could talk about social issues, I could talk about personal issues, I could talk about family, which is my main thing, I have to say. I think it's my main thing. But also I could talk about the way these stories could be meaningful, not just to me, but maybe to a larger audience. And fortunately, Hard Evidence came out, and even though I had some issues with my American publishers, the European market and the Japanese market, God bless them, loved these books, this book, and decided to buy my past two, and actually paid me enough money to live for a year for the first time. And I wrote The 13th Juror, which was dealing with another very large social issue, the issue of battered women. And that had not been done in a mystery novel, certainly, although there'd been a lot of nonfiction books about it. But that was a book that not only let Dismas Hardy finally become an adult, but in which his author, his creator, pretty much had to step up the game and become an adult and deal with these very serious issues in a way that was still entertaining and in a way that expressed things that were important to him and his heart. And so that book, fortunately, became an international bestseller that sold 4 million copies the first year it came out. Since then, every book has been a bestseller, I'm delighted to say, including the one that came out just this week, A Plague of Secrets. And I hope I will continue to be able to do that for a very long time. So thank you.
Our thanks to John Lescroart. And he is the famous mystery author whose latest work is A Plague of Secrets. It's time for the Q&A period. I've received several questions, and if there are any more out there, go ahead and send them my way. I'm going to begin with great palette now.
Good.
All right, so to begin, family was a huge influence, obviously. Talk a little bit about, you mentioned that five of your brothers and sisters also followed their hearts. What are they doing? And then the two that didn't, what are they doing?
Ha ha. Ha ha. Well, that's good. My older sister, Patricia, is a registered nurse. She always wanted to be a nurse. She was my nurse when I was like 2 years old and she was three. We used to just do the whole, you know, hold your tongue down and, you know, she didn't use that nice little wooden stick. But she always was a nurse and she's a nurse in her heart and she's a nurse now. My brother Mike is the ultimate numbers guy. The family's weird. It's a good nature versus nurture look at the world because my family, you'll see as I answer this question, everybody's really different. Mike is the ultimate numbers guy. We used to play games when we were kids with Mike where we would just say strings of numbers. We'd just go 132, 19, 42, 9, 4, 8, 6, 4, 10, 10, minus 3, and Mike would just have the answer right there. And Mike became a CPA and real estate investment guy, and that's what he does. He's just a numbers guy. And ironically enough, one of his sons, is the same thing. He's this is a fascinating, it's almost like a idiot savant thing, except forget the idiot part. These guys are just whips on putting numbers together. It's cool. And then my brother under Mike is Emmett. Emmett is an entrepreneur. He's a very successful businessman in New Jersey. My sister, Lorraine, is a free spirit from the get-go, and Lorraine is a flight attendant and has been a flight attendant forever and is very happy doing that. My sister, Mary Jane, is one of the two. Well, actually, but we're going to hit 6 out of 7. My sister, Mary Jane, is learning disabled, so I can't say that she is, a failure, but she, I don't think, has that view of life that I'm going for that big thing. She does a lot of things. She knits Angora sweaters. She has a house full of Angora rabbits. I know she loves it, so maybe she's got that same thing happening. And then my little sister, Catherine, who is, by the way, the person through whom I met my wife, Lisa, who's in this audience. She is Lisa's college roommate. And Catherine is an artist and mother, and she has always been, that kind of person, a great artist, I think, and a terrific mother. So
that's incredible.
That's it.
So let's talk about Dismas Hardy for a little bit and segue from your family here. How much of your characters are autobiographical, Dismas A?
Well, how could anybody even think that? I mean, I look out over you people and you look like an intelligent group, and I'm thinking somebody out here just doesn't get it. I mean, you know, Dismas Hardy, number one, when he first showed up on the page, he was 38 and I was 38. Okay, one little thing, okay? He lived on 34th Avenue. I lived on 34th Avenue. He worked at the Little Shamrock Bar as a bartender, which I think I did. He married someone 11 years younger than him, and they had two kids, a girl and a boy. Other than that, the great thing that happened in the first few pages that I wrote about Dismas Hardy is I said that he was an ex-Marine, ex-cop, ex-lawyer, and for a while had been a father. None of those things defined me at that time. And fortunately, all of those things became Hardy's backstory, and doubly fortunate, the minute he got on the page, he asserted his own little rascallion way and kind of just made with me as he would. He really does have a stronger sense of stubbornness, I think, even than I do. And I think he is a real zealot for justice in a way that I am not. Although I like to think that I am into justice, I also like to think I have a little bit of a merciful streak. Not a big one, but a little one. And Dismas doesn't really have that too much. He tries to understand, but he still thinks the bad guy's got to go down. And I think that's very satisfying to read about if he's your hero.
When did you know that there was some, not all of it, when did you know that those autobiographical quirks were
Well,
there?
all of my kind of practice pages, you know, that I discussed earlier with, you know, one page at a time, I was constantly trying to find a voice, trying to find a character who worked for me, who I knew intimately. And I was very dissatisfied with all of my results. I had all of these pages of, I mean, pages and pages, I mean, 300-400 pages that I just got back from my archives, actually. I've got archives, this is weird, but I asked them for my early work and they sent me, you know, hundreds and hundreds of pages of just junk. And I said, wow, this is really interesting. But what happened was I started trying to find a voice. And the voice came with a character. And what I wanted to do was somehow, I had this really weird idea that you had to be kind of, to be literary, meant you had to sound different than a voice, than a speaker's voice. And I think what Dismas Hardy finally allowed me to do was to use my voice, my American slang-ridden, semi-profane voice, to be a narrative voice and to kind of get that on the page. And I think that's why we identify with Hardy, because he talks like we talk and his friends talk like we talk. And I was very uncomfortable doing that in all of the years of trying to find a voice, because it didn't sound literary to me. And then, silly me, once Hardy started doing it, I recognized it as, wait a minute, this is an authentic American voice. This guy sounds like a narrator. Even though it wasn't in the first person, his whole value system suddenly was carried in the way he exposed himself by speaking. And so he became kind of, not me, but someone through whom I could be comfortable writing as a literate voice and as a compelling personality.
That's interesting that you bring that up. I think a lot of creative artists have that issue. I'm an actor, and mm-hmm. I think about that. You know, the best acting is when you can just let go and sort of let yourself come out.
It was tremendously, you know, freeing. When I finally decided that, okay, this guy, even though he's got a lot of my characteristics, you know, I won't speak for any of you, but I know that I am often a bozo. It's true. John Lescroix exposes himself as bozo. You know, I often don't have profound thoughts. It's true. Once in a while, something slips by there that's just kind of mundane.
Like just now.
Just now is a good example. But, you know, you have to then, here's a key word, you have to edit. So once I decided that this guy actually most of the time got it right, it freed me up to put in even more stuff and to realize that I could always go back and fix it. And this guy became, to me, a very, very powerful guy in a way that I am not. But that's because I don't get to edit my life. I get to edit his life.
So this question may be sort of a moot point after all that, but someone in the audience wants to know, what has kept you inspired enough to write a 13-novel series? Because even though you found your voice through Dismiss Hardy, mm-hmm. and even though he's provided you a vehicle for what she does, I mean, that you haven't yet moved on, or maybe he's grown with you.
Well, one of the things I decided early on was to make Hardy grow in real time. And that's always a tricky thing because I suspected, but I wasn't sure until now that I'm over 60, that really, it's not the greatest idea ever that a novelist could have. I think John D. McDonald was smarter keeping Travis McGee at 35 forever. But now I'm to the point that really it gets a little bit maybe stretching things to think that Hardy's like this sexy guy. You know, not that, of course, I'm not a sexy guy, but Hardy maybe is probably not going to go on being the love interest in these books. I mean, maybe the love that he has with his wife, Franny, will be strong and powerful, but it will not be like, oh, I wonder what's going to happen next with them. So I have, in fact, introduced younger characters because, you know, if you write, let's face it, the whole novel thing comes from the idea of romance. And, I mean, it's called a roman in French. And it's the reason it's romance is because you got to have some interesting things happening on a personal level. And Hardy is not going to probably be filling that role. I can tell you all right now, I'm never killing Franny. I know people always go, you're going to kill Franny and make it really, you know. James Lee Burke, who I love, you know, has had Robichaud kill four of his wives. I mean, what's wrong with that? I can't do it. So anyway, that's, I don't know if I'm answering the question anymore, but, you know, I'm just talking at this point.
Okay, so a lot of people in the audience want to know about your process. So when you sit down to write a new novel, does the story reveal itself? Do you have sort of the whole outline, or do you just, how do you do it?
Wow. Yeah, the story just reveals itself, and I just take notes and write it down. No, that's not what happens. What happens is, it's what's great is I've been very fortunate to be under contract with my publisher for the last, basically my whole career, after the first two books. So I've always had multiple book deals, and the multiple book deals, luckily, I have arranged so that they begin with an outline on September the 1st, and I hand in the book on June the 1st. And this has been the case for the last 17 or 18 books. So on September 1st, I have to hand in an outline, and my motivation is that is a milestone moment in the contract, which means I get paid. I know that doesn't sound very literate or literary, but in fact, those of us who make a living writing have to get paid from time to time. And it's very haphazard how those paychecks arrive. Often when you hear, for example, about a $100,000 deal from an author, you're thinking, whoa, that's so cool, I get 100 grand. Well, in fact, you get 20 grand when you sign the contract, 20 grand when they accept the outline, 20 grand when they hand in the final book, 20 grand when the book is published in hardcover, and 20 grand when they colonize the moon. So that's the way it works on the publishing end of things. So it's very nice to have a reason to show up on September 1st and say, here's my outline, you owe me. So often, as you may expect, June 1st rolls around. I finish my book, I hand it in, and by the way, I've never been even a day late. Thank you very much, it's very important. I handed my book on June the 1st, and then I do my revisions on that book all the way through the summer. My editor has to read it, my consultants take a look at it and see what's wrong with it in terms of the legal stuff and all that other stuff. But I'm finished the book probably around August 1st, completely finished. I still have the galleys to go and other things, but I'm basically done. But I have to hand in another book in 30, an idea in 30 days. I don't have an idea. I'll tell you that right now. I never have an idea. I'm done. I've done 20 of these books, 21 now in the last 20 years. I'm done. I don't have any more ideas. So I go, here it is, September 1st coming up. So I sit down and I, on August 30th generally, roughly, I think that's pretty much the exact date, I say, well, I got to hand in something, and I sit down and I write 5 pages of what would Hardy probably be doing now. Or if I don't have any ideas about Hardy, I just make up a new guy. And I say, I wonder what Wyatt Hunt's team are doing now. Or what, Gina Roque, I've never written a book about her. Maybe I'll see what she's doing. And I write 5 pages and I send it in. And that's it. That's the outline. Then I start writing the book, based upon what? Quite often I have no idea. I start a few pages and sometimes they work and sometimes they don't. If they don't, I just start a new book. And quite often I'll be, you know, into December by the time I find my new idea. And then I have to write as fast as I can and get it done by June. And the best thing to do at that point is just not think about it very much. Just try to follow your characters and not let your internal editor go be too hard on you and say, this is a dumb idea. You know, because the other thing that happens if you're fortunate enough to have a few bestsellers is the competition gets a little stiff because your publishers, number one, pay you more money, and number two, expect you to write a bestseller every time. And if you don't, you're over. So you're motivated to do it. So you get a little bit nervous about whether it's the big idea. And the lesson that I have learned after these books now is that really the big idea comes out of the writing of the book. It's not out of the initial inspiration of the book, because I have found that if you wait for inspiration, it's a long, dry wait. So that's that answer.
Great. Thank you so much. It sounds like you're fairly disciplined to, you know, because you've never been late. I mean, it may not seem like it, but been late.
No, I'll agree that I'm disciplined.
Yeah.
Impatient and disciplined. Both the two.
So talk a little bit about the publishing process. Now, you have a regular publisher at this point.
Yes.
With a good relationship.
Yeah.
And...
Well. Yes. So hey, come on. To get an author to even say yes in a clipped fashion is very, very big. I mean, you know, I just got back from the International Thriller Writers Convention in New York last week, and the amount of good things the writers had to say about their publishers, I'd say, could easily fit in this cup. So... I'm very happy with my publishers, actually.
That's great.
Yeah.
So when you were initially going out, first of all, why didn't you publish one of those books right out of college?
Oh, well, because I was an idiot, is the real answer. I had no idea how to do it. Nowadays, every little kid who's graduating from college already has an agent. He's got 3 book ideas that he's going to do for series. You know, he's going to have a series character doing this, and then he's going to have his standalone novels going over here. They're amazing, all these kids, because they go to creative writing school, they go to these writing conventions, everybody tells all the trade secrets. It's great. I mean, I spend most of my time reading fiction, first novelists who want to get blurbs on their books because I want to help them. Why? I don't know. Why do I want to help them? They're my competition. They're often very, very good. You know, I'd rather have them struggle for 10 years, you know, or 15 or 20 years, you know. But in fact, they're all really great people, generally. They're living their dream. It's wonderful to see. It's exciting as hell. And I love helping them. But they all know what to do. I had no idea. I finished my first novel. I threw it in a drawer. I finished my second novel. This is a big step. I let my dad read it. One guy. That's it. That's the book that finally got published when I was 37.
What did he say when you read it?
He said, good book. I said, what do you do with it? He goes, I don't know. I don't know. How do you publish a book? I think you have to be born an author before you can publish a book. Nobody knew. Nobody knew any of this. I didn't even meet another author in person until I had published my 5th book. So the idea that I could go up and say hi to Stephen King at a bookstore and shake his hand and say, hey, listen, do you know any agents? I mean, it just did not exist in my world. So That's a sad thing, because I often think what would have happened if I would have taken Son of Holmes at the age of 22 and a half, finished book, you know, and sent it out. I think it might have gotten bought, which is weird to think. And I was just this weekend on a panel with Lisa Gardner. I don't know if any of you know her, but she's a very well-known suspense writer. And she was sitting next to me, and, you know, they said, John, well, this is pretty impressive. You've written 20 books. And she looks at me, and she goes, slacker. She's 33. She published 4 books before she got out of college. I'm going, Lisa, come on. That's not right. So anyway, it just shows that the world has just radically shifted between the time I was doing it and now.
So when you, okay, so I'm gonna go back to the writing process.
Go ahead.
And this is probably a question for your wife, actually, but so what do you, how do you, when you're writing, how is it? Is it just sort of like a day job, you do it and then you're connected to the family and all, or do you sort of, you know?
I believe, and Lisa will stand up and correct me if I'm wrong, please do. I do it as a day job. It's a job. I mean, I didn't start making a living as a writer until I was 45. So I had a lot of day job experience. And what I used to do is get up at 5:30 and go out of the garage and write between 5:30 and 7:30, and then do my day job or two, which I did for many years. So now it's an incredible easy thing for me to get up in the morning at the incredible late sleep-in hour of 7:30. I go work out of the club for a couple hours just because I don't want to be a sedentary rat. And then I go into my office at 10 o'clock, and I work from 10 to 5. And I do that every day. And I think Lisa will tell you that that's true. I don't work weekends. I don't do windows. It's just I go in, do the job. And many days I don't get much done, but I'm in there working it every day.
What's your favorite part about the writing process?
Finishing a book. The writing process is a very often a joyful one, but because of the expectations, I believe, that are on people who have done this enough, and there are expectations, it does get a little bit worrisome. Whether or not I'm even writing about stuff that people care about is a huge issue. The publishing world right now, we're in a very flux state. Everybody at this International Thriller Writers Convention is writing Dan Brown books. I mean, all of them. Everybody that I talk to is writing Dan Brown books. Either that or superhero books. And I don't write that book, and I'm aware of it. And even people who are my exact contemporaries, and I would think my competition, Steve Martini, for example, he writes just the kind of book I write in a general sense. He says he's never writing another courtroom scene in his life. You know, Richard North Patterson, another San Francisco great writer, great friend, also doesn't want to write any more trial books. You know, and here I am coming out with a trial book, and I'm going, huh, wow, nobody else is. I mean, that might be good, but it might be an indication that their publishers told them don't write any more trial books, and for some good reason. So I don't really know. It's the answer. I try to write books that I know I'm going to write books that about social and personal issues and try to make them fun and interesting. But, you know, it might be that in the next publishing round that comes up, they'll say, hey, listen, we really like those trial books, but don't do any more of them. You know, do something else. We really like Wyatt Hunt. And let's go back to that old school formula or whatever they're going to do. And I don't know what they're going to ask me for.
Well, as far as you're concerned, so you write thriller novels, but is there another genre, or are there other genres that you would write in, or other genres you enjoy?
Yes. I really am a romantic slob at heart, and I would love to write kind of adult romance, but not romance, real novels with a romantic element. I think I got a little on that with The Suspect, and a little bit I also experimented with The Hunt Club. But I really like movies that are romantic comedies, and I would love to write the kind of book that would become a romantic comedy someday that isn't schlocky and stupid. But, you know, maybe that could happen. We're going to Provence next year, Lisa and I. We're going to live there for a couple of months in the late summer, early fall. And the plan is that I'm going to write a non-series, non-mystery book, and Lisa's going to paint. So maybe in a year we'll see if that's happened. Nice. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to go back to your novels. There are a couple stories about. First of all, I was curious about this, and so is the audience. You write a lot about the SFPD, so I'm curious, how do you know so much? And has an officer or a representative from the SFPD ever come up to you and sort of questioned you or been upset about anything you've written?
Number one, I don't know anything. I don't know anything about the police department or about the law. Everything I write in the books gets vetted by either Al Giannini, who's a district attorney here in the city for years and now in Redwood City, or by several cops, many of whom might want to remain nameless, but I think a few that I put in my books, I can tell you Joe Toomey is one of them. Napoleon Hendricks is another one. These guys are both well-known San Francisco homicide cops, and there are several others that we work with and that I've had lunch with a lot and talked to, and they're not shy. So it's interesting, all of the insight I get is basically from people who are in life, and I pick and choose what makes my story more fun.
So you were a musician in, throughout your 20s, and I'm assuming you still...
Volare, hey, ho.
So how does your music...
Oh, sorry.
No. That was lovely.
Yeah.
How does your music influence your writing? Do you listen to music while you're writing? Do you listen to it to get inspiration? Where is it in your writing?
I have to say my music and my writing are completely separate. I don't have any noise around me when I'm writing. I can't have any music even in the background because then I start singing along with the darn music. I really love music, and I you know, listen to it on the way to and from work and have it on in the house most of the time. And, you know, I like doing things in the recording studio still, but I think it's a very separate thing. That's because until I was 30, I tried to make a living as a singer-songwriter, and it didn't work. And I have, believe me, a huge backlog of material that there is absolutely no market for. And I've explored that possibility quite a lot, and so I just go, well, this is what we call in the trade a hobby. And it's a great hobby, and it's very fulfilling, and I really enjoy it, and, you know, my wife likes me to sing to her once in a while, not all the time. And, you know, it's a great thing to have something you love that isn't part of your job. And that's what music is now to me.
That's great. Do you remember the first story idea you ever had from childhood? From
Bob and Tom and Lightning and Thunder.
Nice.
Yeah, they were cowboys, and Bob was one, and Lightning was his horse, and Tom was the other one, and... Thunder was his horse, and we did, actually, the family, you know, with the seven kids, it was cool. We had the horses, and we had the kids, and the adults were, I mean, my parents were not Bob and Tom, but I was Bob, Mike was Tom, Emmett was Lightning, and Pat was Thunder, and then we just abused the three little kids terribly, and we had a theme song, because that was the other, that's when the writing and the whole thing came together. It was Bob and Tom and Lightning and Thunder together made a really big storm. We just repeated that forever. That was as far as it went, but that was the very first story idea.
And how old were you?
About seven.
Great.
Seven. So where was CBS? Come on, they should have been there. Yeah.
So throughout your adult professional writing career, what was the most discouraging episode, and how did you deal with that?
Oh, it was a long-standing. That's a great question. I've never been asked that question before. That's a good one. My first publisher was a guy named Donald I. Fine, and Don Fine was a rather infamous publisher in New York in the sense that he basically ran a Ponzi scheme to publish for many, many years. This is well documented. He discovered a ton of famous authors, Elmore Leonard, Ken Follett. He's the guy who first found Dale Brown, Steve Martini, Richard Herman, me, Margaret Truman, a huge, you know, stable of authors. And he lost them all because he didn't pay them. So it got frustrating to me kind of after about book four, when I handed in my book. We moved up to Northern California, and I handed in my book, Hard Evidence, which I thought was a very good book, and he didn't pay me. And he didn't pay me for the whole year. It never went away. And I think the most discouraging moment of that was in that period of time, my young son Jack fell down and cut his lip. Or no, he cut his head. He was always cutting something, but he cut his head this time. And we took him to the hospital, and Don Fine, I called him and I said, Don, look, my son just cut his head open. You know, I don't have insurance. You owe me, you know, $14,000. Can you send me like $100 or something? And you know what he did? He sent a fire engine for Jack. And I think that was about the low point for me. I just said, I'm never gonna actually see any money from this guy ever. And he's my publisher. And that was probably the low point. And he went on, I'll tell you just an interesting story, because finally, obviously, I got away from him. And when I did get away from him, I had the option to audit him. Because I didn't understand why he was so adamant about keeping me in his stable. Because I wasn't making any money, so he couldn't be making any money. Right? Well, I audited him. And the day the auditor showed up, I got a registered check in the mail for $130,000 that he had owed me over the last 5 years and that I had never seen one dime of.
Wow.
And we had been, it's fair to say we were struggling before that. And that made the huge difference that I suddenly could write full time, and that's how I wrote 13th Juror.
Wow, that's incredible.
Yeah.
So on the flip side of that, what are you most proud of, or what was the sort of shining moment?
I think the first time I made the Times list, 13th Juror, and that was, again, Don Fine was still my publisher. I hadn't gotten away from him, and he knew, the sly dog. You know, he had taken me out to a Italian restaurant in New York and arranged to have, you know, a telegraph guy come in with a little red hat, literally. And, you know, it was like this new thing that he'd had no idea was going to come. Little do we know, everybody in the book business knows you get the New York Times list on Wednesday night. And so everybody knows you're already on the list for next Sunday. But I didn't know it, because I didn't even know there was a New York Times list, essentially, that I could ever be considered for. But suddenly here I am, and there's blowing whistles, and there's, you know, there's a cake in the restaurant, and all of this is all prepared. And so it was an exciting moment, because it changed my whole life at that point. Suddenly I was a New York Times bestseller, and that does make a difference in your commercial world. So
yeah, very true.
Yeah.
Are there any of your books that you don't like? Like that you had, and you're like, I don't know if I should turn this in.
You know, I got to be honest with you. No,
that's great.
There are no books of mine I don't like. I mean, you know, you work them so hard. You know, some of them didn't come as easily as others, but almost that's a better thing. They're all my babies. There are some I like a little better than others, and some I don't. I'll tell you one that's interesting to me, just as a matter of interest. My book, The Vig, is, to me, a book that was very much done as an exercise. But it had Hardy, it had Franny, it got them together, I did. But it was really just like, okay, now I'm going to be a mystery writer, not a literary writer, and I'm going to write a mystery. So I sat down, I wrote this mystery, and it's a good mystery. Well, what's amazing to me is that book has been in print now for 25 years. It's earned out. I mean, it makes me thousands of dollars every 6 months. And I just go, this is so weird. It's just not like any of my other books, but everybody seems to love it, so I'm glad. So I love it, too.
Okay.
That's the answer.
This is maybe a strange question, but I really enjoy your snapshots of the city of San Francisco, mm-hmm. and they're very simple and very quick.
No, they're profound.
Yeah, they are. No, I...
Simple.
you talk about, in Betrayal, you talk about Hardy's house, him walking up to the house.
Yeah.
The sunset over the Richmond and Plague of Secrets. And, uh-huh. and I mean, how do you keep it simple and still, I don't know if you know that those are really affecting visual moments.
Well, one of the things I try to do is put the reader in the scene. And the way to do that is to describe the setting. And since I actually lived at Hardy's house, really on 34th Avenue, I know what that Richmond sun setting behind you, those 4 days a year there's actually sun out there. I know what it looks like when it's lighting up the windows and there's like that firefly effect on everything facing you, and it's fantastic. And also the smells down by this Hall of Justice, especially when the flower market was there and they were doing the Graffio's coffee down there. When I was first starting out, that was just unbelievable, that richness of smell. And to try to capture that, I mean, one of the goals, I think, in all writing is to be brief and pithy and funny, or not funny, but at least pithy. And pithy and pithy and non-redundant. So what I try to do is capture those fleeting moments at the moment of their biggest impact, and find the person who would, the person who is in the scene who would have the strongest reaction to that and the most likely reaction to notice it. Because that's the other thing that happens is if you can't have Dismas Hardy going around noticing everything, because nobody's that way. But you can have Glitzky, who is a very different person than Hardy, notice something totally different than Hardy would never notice. But it gives me an opportunity as the author to bring it in from many, many areas and to try to make all of it interesting in its own way.
Yeah. And you also, you know, you mentioned Hardy, you also sort of have him walking through it. And you're right, I don't get the sense that he notices it at all.
No, he doesn't notice a lot. I mean, he's often inside his head.
Yeah.
You know.
So how do you, obviously your work is reviewed. How do you feel about criticism? Do you ever worry about it? Do you read it? You know.
Criticism's good. You know, early on in your career, criticism really helps you develop as a writer. Later on in your career, you learn how beautiful it is to hate critics. But I don't really worry too much about it. I mean, the real criticism is the marketplace, as far as I'm concerned. Of course, you like to get good reviews. Bad reviews are always painful. And they're not painful, really, because you're mad at anybody. You're painful because it didn't work for that reader. And my goal is really, even though you can't please all the people all the time, my goal is to please a lot of people a lot of the time. I do sometimes wonder where, you know, the pool of critics come from. And I think quite often there's jealousy and envy that plays a role in criticism, that these people maybe don't publish as much as they would like and maybe don't sell as many books as I do, and that's not a good thing for them. But you can see that usually in the actual critique. But the good thing is, they say any print is good print, and I kind of subscribe to that more than anything else.
I've got several questions here from the audience about all the new trends in bookselling, electronic book, Kindle,
mm-hmm. Kindle.
Amazon.
Yeah.
So just curious, your thoughts on these new trends, as far as Kindle specifically, I guess.
Well, Kindle is not bad for us, contrary to what many people may have been led to believe, us being authors, because we get paid. It's, you know, it's a download, and we get a buck or whatever it is per download. So it's kind of like a paperback book. It's not the same royalty rate as a hardcover book, but it's not at the other. When you compare it, for example, to the secondhand bookstore that is Amazon, which is the biggest secondhand store in the world, on which I make zero royalties at all. So I'd rather have Kindle any day than all the secondhand books. I mean, on the day that Plague of Secrets came out, you could buy a Plague of Secrets for $24.95 at Amazon, or you could buy it used for $17. And I'm going, who's had time to read it? You know, but really, I believe that they are selling lots of $17 versions as opposed to the $24.95 versions. So if anybody wants to buy it on Kindle, please buy it on Kindle. The sad thing is, I really do think that, you know, not just books, but newspapers, magazines, everybody, I can't imagine that in two more generations we're going to have any more books. I just don't think they're going to be there anymore, and that breaks my heart. But, you know, two generations ago we didn't have television. Get over it. I mean, I do believe that's going to be the future, and I don't think it's stoppable. I mean, between the killing of the trees and the making of the paper and all of those things, it's just so green and so natural, and all the kids in the whole world. And everybody in here under the age of 12, just start clapping? Oh, no. I mean, it's a good example. You know, under 20. Yay! Woohoo! You know, I mean, that's the world now, is you people who read, God bless you, and you read books. And I read books, too. But Kindle is going to be here, and things like Kindle are going to stick around.
Do your children read?
My children are voluminous readers. My daughter is an amazing reader who, you know, read all of the Harry Potter, and so did my son. They read all of the Harry Potter books the day they came out. My son last night I came home and he was watching Harry Potter 6, reading Harry Potter 5, and was going to the midnight showing of the one that opened last night at midnight. And besides that, my son Jack is the ultimate expert in all things John Lescroix. Often, I mean, I give him my very first draft, and the only other person I give a first draft to is Al Giannini. And Jack comes back to me and he goes, Vincent is not 18 in this book. He's 17, Dad. Jeez. I said, how do you know? Well, he was 15 in whatever it was 2 years ago, and I did the math. But he, you know, he's got it all. He's read everything I've written, you know, 5 or 6 times over. It's great.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go back to your father again. It sounds like he was your quintessential influence. What were his favorite authors, his favorite books? Who were his favorite authors?
He was very much a literary reader. He did not read mysteries, and that's why I don't think I grew up reading mysteries. He was Hemingway and Fitzgerald and Saul Bellow, Updike. I mean, he was this kind of a standard bestseller reader from the 50s and 60s. Interestingly, though, the one mystery that he read, he turned me on to. He read Anatomy of a Murder, which was a giant bestseller back in the 60s. And I was still a young kid. I was maybe 13 or 14 years old. And he almost never recommended books to me to read that he had read, probably because he thought I was still 13 and wouldn't quite get them or whatever. But he was always willing to talk about them, but he didn't say, hey, you got to read The New Rabbit Run by John Updike, you know, because I think I probably wouldn't have gotten a lot of the implications of the Updike oeuvre back then. But he did turn to me when he finished Anatomy of a Murder, and he said, you got to read this book. This is a great book. And I said, what makes it go so good? And he said, well, the story is just unbelievable. The guy just tells an incredible story. So I sat and I read that, and it just totally changed my world. I mean, at that point, I started reading The Hardy Boys. I mean, this was not Anatomy of a Murder, but you have to start somewhere. And then I started saying, wow, I like this whole idea of a plot. You know, a plot that moves forward and has something happen, you know, page to page.
Was there anybody else in your life that influenced you as far as your writing and love?
Other authors, yeah.
Yeah, so who are your favorites?
Well, I mean, the people who really drove me in my early life were the masters. I mean, Hemingway and Fitzgerald and, Camus. I studied the continental novel in translation in college, and I was an English major at Berkeley and took it very seriously. Lawrence Durrell, all of these guys, Tolstoy, Dostoevsky, really just the real hard guys. But I loved them, and they kind of got me going. And then when I got into the mystery field, I got turned on to Agatha Christie very early and Sherlock Holmes and the real classics, John D. MacDonald. And now I like Elmore Leonard and Nelson DeMille and T. Jefferson Parker. But I basically don't read too many people in my field anymore. I don't want to copy them. I don't want to be too influenced anymore by them. There's just a few that I read for pleasure.
So I'm curious, in addition to writing one page a day, do you have any other advice that you would give to aspiring writers? And I've got to say, of all the authors we've had here, you've given the most concrete advice.
Good.
So I'm curious, is there any more?
Yeah, I have a very good piece of concrete advice, which I give to every aspiring author in the world. And that is, please finish something. I can't tell you how many times people come up to me and say, I've started four novels, you know, and I got into page 30 on four novels, or I'm 100 pages into something and I just don't know how to do it anymore. I don't know where it's going. And the answer is, nobody knows where it's going. That's the fun of it. You got to just get to the end. And the way you find out how to get over these problems is to address them and not let them beat you. And, you know, it wants to beat you. It's hard. It's hard to get to the end. It's hard to get to the end of a short story or a poem. But that's the only thing that teaches you how to solve the problems that are the real problems that real writers face every day. Because every day I go in and there's a moment, believe me, even if I think I know what I'm doing, that I think, oh my God, this is a dead end. I can't get out of this one. You know. And here's a great little moment. I'll just share this with you. This is courtesy of my friend Bill Wood, who's a great author himself. And he tells the story of these two guys who wrote these, not conflicting, but, you know, one guy had to write one episode one day and the next episode the next day, and they put it in the paper every day, and they had to keep up, and they kept challenging the other person to see how hard it can be for the next day. So the one guy finishes up one day, and he's got his hero. He's taken out to the middle of a lake in a boat, and he's in a safe in the boat, and he's got handcuffs on, and they throw the safe overboard. And it sinks into the bottom of a bottomless lake that's like 11,000 feet deep. And the next day, the next episode starts out, when he got to shore, that's how you get out of that one. And you know, and we see that in movies. Think about movies you've seen. It's like your guy jumps out of an airplane with no parachute, and the next thing you know, he's running down the road. And you go, wow, something must have happened in there. And, you know, the imagination is a wonderful thing, and it'll supply that missing link. But as a real exercise in what you need to do if you want to write, you need to finish. That's it.
Thank you. And that brings us to the end of our incredible discussion. We are finished.
I just finished.
Our thanks to John Lescroart, famed mystery author whose latest work is A Plague of Secrets. We also thank our audiences here and on radio, television, and the internet. Tonight's program has been part of the Commonwealth Club's Good Lit series, generously underwritten by the Bernard Osher Foundation. I'm Gina Bellaria, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, celebrating more than a century of enlightened discussion, is adjourned. Thank you.